Sao nói bộ South Street this evening for our church carol service. It's really good to see you. Really glad that you've made it this evening. We appreciate a number haven't been able to make it, so a warm welcome to those on the live stream as well. We know that actually some who've not been able to make it were meant to be singing in the choir tonight, but that is the way the world is at the moment. So we're glad that you'll be able to join us over the airwaves or live in person. So we're going to pray that the Lord would bless our time together. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we have a chance to meet and we have something to celebrate together. And we pray that we would celebrate lifting our hearts and minds and souls to you in worship. Amen.
Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel."
God is the supreme being and creator of all. This song speaks of how he came down from heaven to earth to bring good news and to be our saviour to free us from sin. The chorus says, "Glory to God in the highest." To glorify him means that we are to acknowledge the greatness and splendour of his majesty through honour, worship and praise, of which he alone is worthy, because he is God of all. This song is called "From Heaven Above to Earth I Come."
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh,
oh, clap, we don't mind. If you don't think it's any good, you don't have to clap. You do what you do. Feel free to. Shall we stand together and sing our next song, which is Angel Somewhere Else? There's plenty of instrumental, please have along with instrumental, and you can go for the rest. Okay. 1, 2, 3.
For to us a child is born, To us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Our next song is a 16th century carol in Latin called Gaudete, which means rejoice. And it has the refrain, rejoice, rejoice, Christ is born of the Virgin Mary, rejoice. And it's a carol of praise for God's grace, blessing and love as God became one of us. This opens the gates of heaven for us as his transforming light shines and we praise the King of our salvation. There have been many different versions of Gaudete recorded over the last few decades, and we're going to sing it in the original Latin with an English translation will be on the screen.
Gaudete, Gaudete,
ding-dong merrily on board. I'm sure you've all heard our version before. What happened is just extra ding-dongs. And it's extra fast. Yeah, apart from that, it's like every other ding-dong you ever hear. So please stand with us, please sing, please clap along and stamp your feet and get your head next to you for this enthusiastic view. Here we go.
But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. Your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left him. "He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even your Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
Thank you.
Our next song is a song which just sums up everything about the Christmas message, saying that today is the Saviour's day. This is the day when the Lord came and he came to die. Sorry, he was born so that one day he could forgive us from our sins and everything we have done. This is a wonderful song full of, your sister's fingers turn red at various points because it's very, very high. It's not actually very fast, it's just very high. And this is a beautiful song. I really hope you enjoy this. It mentions Walsall, it mentions the West Midlands, and it talks about how the reason we come together today is because today is the Saviour's day.
One, two, three, four, five, six.
Before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. which judges the husband's faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name of Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us.
My next song, How Suddenly a Baby Cries, is about how the birth of a baby changes the world and individual lives forever. It speaks of those we read about in the Bible who were changed because of the birth of Jesus. From Mary, who perhaps trembled as she held her son, pondering what it could all mean. The shepherds who heard the message through the angels, and to the Magi who brought their gifts and knelt before the king. It also mentions Anna, who had prayed continually, and to Simeon, who had waited a long time for the Messiah. And throughout history, many lives have been changed as they received grace through his child, Jesus. And how today our voices too can join in songs of praise to Jesus if we have come to know him as our Saviour.
Thank you.
Oh, it's solid.
Okay, please stand as we sing our next song. Again, thank you, Zachariah, for standing. Thank you. Zachariah and I will sing our next song. Please stand to sing our next song. If you've never been to our carol service before, this is the one where we go mushroom. Okay, so there's just a little bit where we sing the following thing. It goes like this. And then at some point we break into a song. So please sing with us, God bless you, Mary Jane. Go!
Praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those whom his favour rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which was just as they had been told. We thank God for sending his beloved son Jesus to be born in Bethlehem, just as the early scriptures foretold. As Christians, we also thank him that our hearts too become his birthplace, as we accept him into our lives and ask him to be born in us today and to abide with us. And this offer is open to us all. We can all enter in and receive him into our hearts today. This song is called A Little Town of Bethlehem.
Yeah.
not know, the Puritans tried to ban Christmas many years ago, and for some reason only one Christmas carol was allowed to be sung for about 70 years, and that carol was While Shepherds Watch Their Flocks One Night, which is the next one we're going to sing. I think it was probably allowed to be sung because it was literally a quote from the Bible, with just being slightly tweaked to make it right. So I think that's why the Puritans didn't mind that one being sung, as opposed to all these others that they thought were terrible. So we're going to sing While Shepherds Watch, which tells the story, which we've already heard read, of the birth of Jesus, and then the shepherds come to visit. There are about 50 different versions of While Shepherds Watch Their Flocks By Night, and this is yet a different one. We're going to sing to you. Two years ago we did one. I said I wanted to transport us back to the court of Henry VIII to the sound, and that's what we're trying to do here again. May not. But please enjoy our version of While Shepherds Watch Their Flocks By Night.
Jesus.
Bethlehem in Judea. During the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. They opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Yeah, please stand with us to sing "We Three Kings of Orient." Stand together. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you.
and it's about God showing his love in the greatest gift of all, in sending his son as he was born in Bethlehem, and then laid his life down as he wore a crown of thorns. And just like a circle that doesn't have an end point, so is God's love too is eternal.
Two, three, four. Children born not of natural descent,
nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Before we have our closing song, I've been asked to reflect just a few moments on the Christmas message. I'm going to read to you a summary of a famous story. I want to see if you can guess what the story is. I'm going to read a summary, just seven words, and see if you can guess what the story is from these seven words. Secret vegetable, under mattress, determined royal bride. What story is being summarised there? With sympathy. Oh, that was very straightforward. Okay, six words then. Builder's work, tested by canine breath. A bit more tricky. Builder's work, tested by canine breath. Three little pigs. And about five words then. Haunted rich man changes life. Christmas carol, that's perhaps a bit more straightforward. But what if I told you that the Christmas message in the Bible is summed up in just four words? Christmas story is told to us at length, in great detail, in Matthew and in Luke and in other parts of the Bible as well. But in John's Gospel, the passage that was just read to us, John summarises the Christmas story in just four words. He summarises the message of Christmas like this. If you picked up as Alan was reading to us, he said, "The Word became flesh." Four words that sum up the Christmas message. I want to say something about those four words just briefly tonight to help us reflect, then we'll sing our final song in closing. The Word became flesh. Now, on the 5th of May 1961, the Russian astronaut Yuri Gagarin was the first man to go in space or orbit. I don't know exact details, but legend has it, and we're not quite sure if this is true or not, but legend has it that he was supposed to have said, "I see no God up here." That's how many people think about God, isn't it? That we're down here and God is up there. If only we could get up there, we'd be able to see God. We sort of imagine a house where we live downstairs and God's the man in the attic, that sort of thing. That's not how the Bible describes our relationship to God. He's not the man upstairs. He's not the big man in the attic. The relationship between us and God is more like the relationship between the author of a book and the characters in the book. So, for example, let's take the Christmas carol that I just mentioned earlier. So the main character in the Christmas carol is Ebenezer Scrooge, and the author of the book is Charles Dickens. Is it possible for Scrooge and the characters in the book, is it possible for them to know about the author? Do they know about the author? Is it possible? Well, it's only possible if the author says something about himself to the characters. So the author could write the story in such a way that Ebenezer Scrooge goes to a bookshop and picks up a biography of the life of Charles Dickens and reads it. And therefore the character in the book finds out about the author. But it would be even better if the author of the book was to write himself into the story. So if the author became a character in his own book. The Bible says, in a way, that's sort of what happens at Christmas time. John explains it like that. He explains this character he calls the Word. And he says the Word is the author of the whole show. The Word is a divine title to describe God. He said the Word made everything. He's the author. In the same way that an author like C.S. Lewis created the world of Narnia, in which his characters would dwell, or Tolkien created the world of Middle-earth, isn't it, in Lord of the Rings, in which his characters would live. So, the Bible says the author, God, he's the Word, he's the one who speaks and writes, and he creates the whole show, the universe, the heavens and the earth. And then John says this character, God himself, the author, he says, in him was life. He's the author of life. But how can we find out about the author? Well, like Charles Dickens and Ebenezer Scrooge, God could reveal things about himself to the characters, to us. That's what God did at first. The Bible says this. In the past, God spoke to people through prophets. So God revealed something about the author, something about himself to prophets. Then prophets said, look, this is what God is like, and this is what God requires of you. But the Bible says that God had planned a better way to reveal himself to the characters in the story, to us. A better way for the author to reveal himself. The Bible says that God would write himself into the story. That God would enter the pages of human history so that the author would become a character in his own story. And John puts it like this. The Word became flesh. God became man. The author writes himself onto the pages of human history at Christmas time. You see, the human story is really a sad story, isn't it? We're living through some things at the moment, aren't we, that are causing people great distress and fear and anxiety, and that's just on top of all the other things that people experience in life, suffering and loss and grief and sickness, terminal illness, inequality, injustice, prejudice, and all the whole range of human experiences and sadnesses, great joys in life, but also incredible grief and sadness. And of course, the human story has one great ultimate sadness at the end, a sad ending. It is a story with a sad ending. But the message of Christmas is that God writes himself into that sad story in Jesus. So Jesus experiences our sadnesses. Jesus suffers. He was poor. He experienced extreme poverty at times, sometimes homeless. He grieves the loss of his adopted father. He has to seek asylum in another country. He experiences rejection from his own people, in fact, from his own brothers and sisters as well. And then Jesus experiences the way all human stories end, with death. And as Jesus dies, the Bible describes that what happens on that cross is like a substitution. A substitution takes place where Jesus experiences our story, our sadnesses, our shame, our guilt, our wrongdoing. Jesus is treated as if he were us, the characters in the story. But then something incredible happens, we're told in the Bible. Jesus rewrites the end of the story. The human story is always the same, it ends in death. But the Bible says 3 days later, after Jesus' crucifixion, he is raised from the dead. He rewrites the end of the story. He rewrites it with a happy ending. And just as he took on our story on the cross, our story of sadness and wrongdoing and shame and guilt and mistakes and failures, he takes that on himself. So the Bible says that Jesus offers his story, the story with a happy ending, to be our story. He offers to rewrite our story to match his. A story that does not end in death, but in resurrection and eternal life and glory. Jesus becomes the author of a new human story. The Bible describes it like this. It says, in Adam all die. The Bible speaks of Adam as this first human being. And because we're all therefore sons of Adam, we all share in Adam's story, which is a story of death. But it says, though in Adam all died, the human story is a sad story, though in Christ all are made alive. This rewriting of the story, the the Bible compares to a new birth, being born into a new story, a new start, a new beginning. We don't think so tonight, I think we sang this morning, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. It says this: He was born to give us a second birth. He was born so that we might be born into a new family, a new story with a new ending. That's why John can say this, as has just been read to us. The Word became flesh. The author becomes part of the story. He made his dwelling amongst us. He lives out our human story. And therefore, to all who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God. Children not born naturally or by human decision or a husband's will, but children who are born of God. Let's pray for us. And then I think we're going to be allowed to give at least one more song before we close. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that although we live in a world of many great sadnesses, and maybe some of us are experiencing those in a very real way at the moment, we thank you for the message of Christmas, in which the author becomes a character in the story, writing himself onto the pages of human history that he might rewrite the end of the story. That though God intended that we might live happily ever after with him and enjoy all the blessings and wonders of his love and grace, yet we know your word speaks about how we have drifted away from that and tried to write our own story away from God and reject the author of life. And yet you have come into this world to rewrite our sad story with a happy ending, that we may know you, Lord, your love, mercy and grace as our Saviour and our Lord, in whose name we pray.
Thank you so much for coming tonight and joining in our carol service. It does mean so much to us to have people come and join you with us. Please stand to join to sing our last carol.
Our last carol is a double carol. It's Hark the Herald, then it goes into A Come Ye Faithful, separated by a last guitar solo from Ashley. So please stand and sing with us the last two carols.
Thank you.
thank you to everyone who's taken part. Can we give everybody a round of applause? Both those of you. Also, those who worked so well behind the scenes as well, preparing things and getting the room ready and the refreshments as well. Big thanks to all those who've been involved. Let's just close in prayer together. Lord Jesus, we praise over this Christmas period. We enjoy all the wonderful things, the wonderful blessings of this time of the year, but also we pray that those things would point us to the great message of Christmas as well. May you touch our hearts and minds with what you've done in this world for us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.